South Dakota's educational effort to raise awareness about the importance of soil health continues. The USDA Natural Resources Conservation Service entered into a cooperative agreement with the South Dakota No-Till Association and iGrow South Dakota State University Extension for delivering these seminars with the latest soil health and productivity technology to South Dakota farmers and ranchers.
Do a survey as I go all over the country. My question to you, ladies and gentlemen, when you're going to learn about agriculture and you had a person mentor you, either a professor, a parent, a grandparent, maybe a friend, they say to you, your job is to farm in nature's image, or to help others farm in nature's image, to work with it, to collaborate with it, to synergize with it, and here's this word, to nurture it. Or did we learn control and command, to be able to force it, to till it, to use herbicides, fertilizers, which are not wrong with themselves, if unused unwisely. But I'm gonna ask you, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you were taught how to farm in nature's image? Whether you were taught in school, or with your friends, a relative, please raise your hand. You are a rare human being. I'm gonna share with you, ladies and gentlemen, I am a product of a person. When I went to agronomy school, learned agriculture in the wrong premise. And I want to submit to you humbly, and I want to show you that agriculture was built on the wrong premise. It was not built on the premise to nurture and to synergize with it. The reason I'm saying this to you, ladies and gentlemen, because as I've gone through the whole country, I am observing the stress among our farmers, dealing with the climate, dealing with economic stress. I started experiencing that with my farmer when we lived in Idaho that was going broke, and he could not bring his son into the operation. And I said to myself, how many acres do we need to farm to really support the family? Why are we farming thousands and thousands of acres, and why can't we not support the family in small acreage and bring the son and daughter back? Ladies and gentlemen, we are working against nature. We are working against her, and I want to show you today how we can farm in her image, how to work with her. And the way we learn that is to learn how soil functions. With that in mind, I ask this to the audience, I also say this to the audience, how many of you, raise your hand, would get in the airplane with a pilot that knows nothing about aerodynamics? Please raise your hand. You would, because you're a pilot, aren't you? Ladies and gentlemen that farm and are producers, I humbly submit to you, we are farming and ranching, and why do we know so little about our soils? Even if I went to graduate school for soils, I too say this humbly, I know very little about soils. And we're going to change that today. We're going to learn how our soils work. And we're gonna start off this way. You ready, Jason? I start off with this demonstration. I do not go anywhere without doing this demonstration first. Okay, let's go up here. And I'm gonna select three or four persons to come and do that. And Josh, you look like you're the perfect person. And I'm gonna, Levi, you wanna come up here? Now, let's see if we can project this onto the big screen. All right, beautiful. Can everybody see that? Anybody see that? In fact, people on the back rows, can you see that? If you cannot see that, I want you to come over here, because the next time you have a desire to run your disc or your rototiller, I hope you break out into a rash after you see this demonstration. Because I tell you what, if I would have known what I'm going to teach you today, I would have broken out to rash. What I'm going to share with you today was not taught to me at graduate school of soils. It is very disappointing. And the knowledge and the information and the science has been around for years. Okay? Let's go over here and we're going to tell you what this is. Josh, Levi, in fact, I'm probably going to need two more persons I'm going to choose. I always like to choose the persons with the folded arm. Arlen, come up here, man. Mark, how do you pronounce your name? Marv, come up here, Marv. You guys ready? You have to do the talk. No, I'm just kidding. I don't want to get all stressed here all of a sudden. You'll walk away. I had one lady refuse to come up here. She was very shy. Come here, okay, we're going to start. You guys get ready. Get you involved here. Let's see, you and I don't trip.
Yeah.
Okay, this test is called the slake or aggregate stability test. It is one test. It is only one indicator of soil health. When you go to the doctor does many tests. He does a blood sample, a urine sample, a saliva sample. He does many tests, CAT scan. He will tell about function. He will talk about health. Indicators that can tell if you're functioning. This is one indicator to show if your soil is healthy or functioning. But it is only one indicator. It will not work on all farms. It'll work on 95 to 98% of the farms. And the reason it won't work, because of the mineralogy. It just won't slake. Slaking means it's starting to fall apart. So what we're going to do is Josh is going to hold my North Carolina soils. This one, I want you to show the picture of that. Look at the soils. These are the same soils. This is Ray Stier's soil. This is conventional soils from Piedmont soils. These are inherently poor soils. They're not high in fertility, very acidic. Organic matter is 0.5% to 1% on that soil. Pan over here. This is Ray Stier's soil. His organic matter is 4 to 6.5%. We just measured it about 3, 4, 5 months ago. Same soils, 1 mile apart. This is conventional vegetable. This is a silage operation, stocker feeder. How do you get the soils like that? And because the native soils in North Carolina before Europeans entered were 3%. How did he beat the forest? Zero tillage, and I mean zero tillage. Multi-species cover crops, he's been doing multi-species cover crops for 20, 30 years before they even became sexy. Okay? Puts manure, but he does not have manure enough to go back on the land, doesn't cover enough. He no longer uses inorganic nitrogen. He has not used inorganic phosphorus in 9 years. He's gone down from 5 herbicides down to 1. Producers, you should be able to do the math in the head if it's economically viable, understanding soil health. Okay? I always bring my North Carolina soil, and then, young man, Levi, you're going to do the beautiful South Dakota, the dark soils. On the right hand, Jeff, tell us the management, please.
That's the no-till.
The conventional.
Conventional till. Corn, soybeans, loam surface in it, soil. Been in corn, soybeans for a number of years, actually within weeks, probably 15 years ago. At this point, we're looking at a spring tillage system, typically spring disking for that tillage operation on that soil. No-till is a corn, soybean, wheat. With cover crop calling, the wheat within rotation. Been no-till for 15 years. Same soil, actually both of these are collected right across the fence from each other. Same soil in it, loam surface.
Okay, thank you, Jeff. Now, I want you to do this in your own operation. How many of you guys have seen the movie Mythbusters? You guys have seen that? And they tell you, I'm a professional, don't do this, you'll get hurt. I want you to do this on your farm. The only thing that makes me hurt is your feelings. Okay? Ready? Let's come up here. We're going to gently drop these pads, these clods, into the soil. And this is the way it's going to work. As the water rushes in to fill the pore spaces, internal pressures are going to build up. If the biotic glues and the cementing agents are not present, they will start to slake and fall apart. If it falls apart, no porosity. No porosity, no infiltration. We want our soil to hold together as those pressures build up. This will show us if these biotic glues, these organic matter complexes, these organic matter is present in the soil. Okay? Ready? Go ahead and gently drop them in to the container. Now, I always collect our North Carolina soils. I collect soils from here. I collect soils from Iowa. Get this in Hawaii. I've done this in Alaska. And the same thing happens all over the planet where you have soil. This happens. Now look at here. These two that are falling, I call these high stress systems. When I say the word disturbance, I like the word stress. One thing our soils can handle, acute stresses, but it cannot handle chronic stress. It's very similar like the body. The human body can handle acute stress. Like if you lift weights, it thrives on that. That stress, it can handle the stress. It was designed. Our ecosystems, our soil ecosystems can handle stress, but they cannot handle chronic stress. Chronic stress is when you put too much fungicide, insecticide, chemical fertilizer, and tillage, and then it collapses, just like the human body. It gets sick. These soils, look how they're falling apart. Look at here. Let's put these two soils together. Total different regions climatically. Look at the same thing occurring. If I dropped a prairie soil, if I dropped a forest soil, they would not fall apart. They would not fall apart. Nature does not till. Tillage is the most intrusive, destructive thing we do in modern agriculture. It is destructive. Tillage is not your friend. Ladies and gentlemen, the farmers that are learning how to farm in nature's image are making money. They're making money because they're learning not to work against nature. Biomimicry. Now I have a question for you guys. Mark, why is this falling apart? And by the way, I want you guys to feel comfortable. I did not know this.
Because it has nothing to hold together.
What happened to the glues, Marv? And the biotic cementing agents? What happened, guys? We need to know this. We need to know this. What do you think? Josh? Levi? We should know this. As you run that vertical till, you run that disc, you stimulate the soil and you wake up these bacteria called R. strategis or coprotrophic bacteria. They are opportunistic. They're designed to be in all soils. They are designed to be there. As soon as a cow pie drops, as carbon drops, they multiply. They're designed to be there. The problem is when you run the disc, you stimulate them, and they start to cannibalize the house. They eat the house. They eat the biotic glues. They eat the cementing agents. Kind of works like cancer, if you think about it. Cancer in the body gets triggered by certain stresses, starts to fray the genes, and it starts to consume the body. This system, if it's done right, it's a natural process, but when it gets sick and you quit the chronic stress, it starts to consume itself. I had a rancher say, Ray, I am not going to stop disking. I'm not going to stop disking because when I do this, it releases nutrients, and it's true. It's called priming the soil. And I said, Mr. Rancher, I said, why you're burning the house down just to warm up a hot dog? It would have been better to turn the grill on. When you do that disking, you also bring weed seeds to the top of the surface, and these soils are bacteria dominant now, and weeds love to proliferate in very heavily tilled bacteria dominant soils. So guess what we did, Mark, when I was running that rototiller? I was not only destroying the house, giving off organic matter, I was bringing weeds to the top of the surface, and the weeds said, thank you very much. Nature's scabs and healers are the weeds. Okay, let's go to the next place here. So, oh, by the way, who makes the glues? Who makes the organic matter, audience? Come on, no lunch.
Biology.
The biology does. It's the bacteria, it's the earthworms, the roots, all the living biology. The soil is alive. It's they that do it. Oh yeah, and we have some chemistry. But it's the biology that makes the biotic glues. Organic matter is somebody's dead carcass, urine, fecal. Everybody eats each other. It's the metabolic processes when they decompose the plant, the carbon, and the byproducts create these beautiful organo-mineral complexes. They hold the particles in space and give it porosity. When you don't have porosity, you have no infiltration. Everybody with me? Okay, now, let's prove that. Josh, Levi, let's... Oh, you guys did the last ones. Come on, let's do that. And I'll get you to do this one. Ready? We're going to make it rain. Okay, and you farm?
Yes.
And you want the water in the soil, don't you?
Right.
You don't want it running off, right? How many inches of rain do you get?
You're up
19. You want every inch, don't you? Well, let's see what's happening. Conventional? No-till. And we did your soils. Because if I do my soils, you know what you guys would say? It sucks to live in North Carolina. Yeah, we know how you think. Okay, now, you're going to pour. Now, it is only 6 to 8 inches. Look at the distance. We're going to pour, and there's going to be holes in the bottom, and we want to see which one. And he's going to zoom in, and we're going to pour, and we want to see which one. All we did is place the soil in the surface. Okay? Ready? At the same time. Get set. Pour. Oh my goodness, the no-till. See, I thought if you till the soil, you create more fluffiness and more pore space. Raise your hand if you thought that way. Everybody should raise their hand. You thought the same way. I remember when I designed a center pivot, I designed it, I get a phone call from the farmer, and the farmer says, don't you know how to do the center pivot package? I turned the water on and all the water ran off my field. I could not defend myself. I had not known he had dissed and destroyed the integrity of the soil. The biotic glues and the cementing agents were not there and the water ran off. Look at that. Zoom in that one right here. Isn't that interesting? It is the living biology. I had never thought that the microbes were connected to the water cycle. No microbes, no water cycle. The water cycle is complete when the water goes into the soil, not runoff. I told the EPA, EPA, we don't have a runoff problem. We have an infiltration problem, a soil function problem. Now, we got another demo. Let's stand up these guys right here like a mugshot. Okay, Josh, you hold this. We got another demo. Levi. Now, gentlemen, you're going to be our little rain cloud, okay? Come on this side. Now, it's got holes on top, okay? Okay, can you guys get these guys real good? Okay, what we're going to do before you do that, we're going to make it rain. Now, keep in mind, this was only 8 inches. Can you imagine when the raindrop comes from the sky and it's coming at 10 to 20 miles an hour? And it plugged the macro pores on this one with only 8 inches. Now let's see what happens when we don't have aggregate stability. The aggregates in the soil, these glues that fuse them, only last 27 days in a typical agro ecosystem, in a typical farm. We have to build glues all the time. Let's see what happens when the glues are gone, when the rain comes in. Because I've always wondered, why do our lakes look like chocolate? And why, when it blows, is the sky covered with dust? Let's look at this and go ahead and spray. Go ahead and squirt it. These are the same soils. Same exact soils. Now, the participants back here, after they're done, they had to drink that water. Which one do you think they'll want to drink? It's got a little bit of iron in there. Okay. Yeah, that's excellent. Let's look that up. Thank you. You're a good rain cloud. Very good rain cloud. Now raise that up and show them. Bring it down just a little bit. Look at the integrity. It's still intact. Look at this one. It's completely dissolved. This one has those biotic glues, those cementing agents. Those glues help increase cation exchange capacity. It helps hold negative ions. If dipole positive, dipole negative, these glues are phenomenal. But they only last 27 days in an agro ecosystem. So how do we get them? Carbon, food, manures, cover crops, your corn, your soybean, anything that leaks carbon, and the microbes process it and create those magical glues. Okay? Now, stop this one here. Now, my wife's from Missouri, and those people from Missouri said, "Now, Ray, you put a boulder here." I've had farmers say, "You put Elmer's glue." I've had that happen. And I said, "Okay, Josh, I want you to open this up and tell me, and tell the audience if the water entered that clot." Okay, break it open. Did it get all the way through? It went all the way through. Those glues are hydrophobic. They shed water. You can keep those clouds in there submerged in that for weeks. For weeks. Now, you guys ready to see the real fertilizer? Most of you guys think real fertilizer comes in a bag 4600, right? Yeah, you do. I'm going to show you the real fertilizer of the soil. What drives the soil. Harlan, you ready? Levi, we'll get these guys to do this. This is called the scum test. I learned this from Dr. Chris Nichols. You're going to hold that corn, and you're going to hold that sod, and this is what you're going to do. You're going to get this sucker like a little plunger, and you're going to swish it around in the water, and we're going to see these incredible scum come to the top. This scum, some of it's called glomalin, and all of these organic, all of these carbon compounds that plants do leak. Plants leak this. Let me show you. Let's go ahead and do it, and then we'll show you and we'll talk about it. Swish them around vigorously like a plugged-up toilet. Give you some visuals there. Boom, boom, boom. Why would plants leak anywhere from 30 to 50? Some plants will leak 70%. Weeds only leak 20% of these substances in the soil. Weeds put all their energy into seed. These plants will leak all their energy into the soil. Why would they do that, Jesse? Why? Why are they leaking this cool compound? Now, that's excellent. Look at that corn. Whoa. Let's put that in here, guys. I'll make a mess. Everywhere I go, I make a mess. It's okay. Now, look at the scum. Can you get it? Look at the scum at the corn. Why is all these glues, the glomalin, and all these compounds? These plants will leak carbohydrates. They will leak sugars, proteins, natural allopathic chemicals. They have like a, this is the soil's iPhone. They communicate to these microbes and turn these microbes on. And say, "We're here, plants communicating. Let's build a relationship." This is liquid sun. This is the storage that is storing and fusing our particles together, but it's also a communicator to our organisms. This is why no-till will not work without cover crops, will not work without diversity. Agriculture will not work without a living plant. I can farm without fertilizer. I can farm without herbicides, but I cannot farm without a living plant. The soil, the plant, is a transformer, a biological primer. It feeds the soil. Now I'm going to ask a question. Why, again, would they leak so much of these precious liquid sun into the system? Gentlemen? Nobody likes in the front, right, Chris? Why would they do that? It's like me saying, okay, Chris.
Next year's.
Come on, Chris.
For the next year's crop.
Yeah, they're doing it for the next year's crop. It's like, think about it. I'll leak 40 to 50%. It's like the government. You work, and I'll take 40 to 50%. But they're getting something out of it. What are they getting out of it? What are the plants getting out of this?
Something for their seed.
It's with the microbes. They say, we'll leak these compounds, and we will give you phosphorus. We will give you zinc. They feed the mycorrhizae. They feed all these organisms. They say, we will take the rock, the zinc, and the minerals out of that matrix and feed you. It's a beautiful, elegant, collaborative, mutualistic association. We feed you carbon, you give us nutrients. Isn't that how cool it is? That is elegance. People that say to me, I don't want to do cover crops. You do not understand soil function. Cover crops are not optional. It's like a utility bill. We all love electricity, don't we? Suck it up and pay the utility bill if you want to farm. Once you understand how soil functions, you never miss cover crops. You never miss diversity because it runs the system. Would you guys give these guys a hand, please? You know why I have to do that demo? You have to drink the pink Kool-Aid of soil health first because you're not teachable until we do that. I had to go through this same routine for me because I had paradigms that were not so. I had the wrong map, the wrong filters. I was taught the wrong filters, the wrong way of looking at nature. Okay, let's start on our journey towards soil health. Okay, let's go. Let's see if I don't have a problem with this computer locking up because I had that yesterday. Okay, good, works good, we'll turn it on. Oh, it's working. AJ, now I got two more principles that I added personally. These are the seven principles. When I walk on a farm in an operation, they are always going in my mind. I run these in my mind, so when I look at your operation and you ask me to come, and if I'm blessed to be part of your life, I run these principles. The first one, very important, the right map. Understand your social and ecological context. It's context, context, context. It is so critical. We impact the resource. You cannot separate the ecology from the sociology, from the social. Cannot do it. We've been doing it for years. That's the farm. Here I am. No, you are part of the farm. It is your life. You affect the resources. The new one I added, it's called Apply the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. As I go all over the country and see the best farmers in the country, they are applying the principles, the habits of highly effective people. I bought this book years ago by Stephen Covey, and guess what? Didn't get it. It was like licking ice cream behind a windshield. Wasn't ready. So I bought it recently, and I said, oh my goodness, I'm a mess. Unless you build these habits and have the integrity, you cannot follow the other principles effectively. You will not stick to it. You will still be out of context. The next one, reduce chemical, biological, and physical stress. You notice how you say disturbance? I like stress, because the soil and the ecology is healthy. It's alive. Stress. Cover the soil all times. Grow living roots. Synergize with diversity, rotations, and cover crops. And the last one, integrate diversity of animals. If you apply one of them, it helps. But if you apply all of them, you will have true freedom. You will have true freedom in farming, because your soils will get so healthy and you will not have the financial stress. We'll talk about that in a little while. Context. Let's look at our context. This is the biggest problem I see all over the country. I wake up in the morning, I know I'm 99.9% of the problem. My wife reminds me. She goes, you're the problem. All of us are the problem. The way we look at it is the way we look at our soils. We look at our soils as a growing medium, a chemistry set. I did the same thing. More of our social context. These are going to be the things that are going to stress our modern agriculture. Water and energy. We need to look at the global context. It is no longer about South Dakota. It is not longer about North Dakota. It is about the world. The Chinese, it was interesting, in this 2012, they had a 60-mile pileup, and people were stuck in the car for 10 days. They interview this young Chinese. He says, I don't care. I want a car. This year, they beat Americans in buying cars. Where is all the energy going to come, ladies and gentlemen? We are breaking the fundamental principle of science. You cannot have infinite growth with finite resources. Even bacteria understand that. No food, you die. Our modern agriculture is run by this, ladies and gentlemen. This is what makes us fragile. This huge, complicated infrastructure. Fertilizer, herbicide. When people, remember how it happened in Louisiana and people were stuck in the dome? How long did it take them to get water? You guys remember that? 5 days. I have a question for you. How many of you feel that the government's going to deliver you when you have problems? Do you believe in that matrix and that structure? I'd rather trust in my soil. I'd rather trust if I work with nature, I can be free and not be dependent on that complicated structure. This is what makes us fragile. This is what makes our farms fragile. It is driven by this, the herbicide, the delivery of the seed. For us to get here, that precious resource drives modern agriculture. It is not a robust system. More context. Context, context. Look at our soils globally. They are degraded all through the globe. Me personally, I think this is a national emergency. We should be so driven as a people to change this situation in our country. Our country is not much better than other countries. Look where we're at. Jay, you've seen that. I was in Colorado when that happened. I am 53 years old. I thought I'd never see the Dust Bowl. We have been working on 75 years, and we still look like this. We have science. We have the best science in the world, we claim. But why are we still here? Arkansas, this year. This is Arkansas. Our soils are blowing. And I had a researcher from North Carolina. She says, well, Barb, we don't have problems. Everything's fine. Really. I fly all over the country. I took that picture on the window seat on an airplane. I told EPA, our lakes and rivers are filled with conservation plans and nutrient management plans, but not crystal clear with understanding. Why? Even Milton, back in 48, president. It is our greedy attitude towards the soil, and we want to solve it with programs. We want to throw money at it. This is what I see as I travel the whole globe, even in Hawaii. Everywhere we see the soil is naked, hungry, thirsty, and running a fever. Because we have a lot of informational knowing, but it's not personal knowing. See, personal knowing, it's personal to you. You understand. When you go to Dr. Beck's farm, you don't dig in the soil without permission. It's personal. I have farmers in Indiana who will not allow you to get on with a tractor. They're not going to let their workers put the lunchbox on the tractor. Too much weight. I was talking to Rick this morning. He travels that. He watches his, Rick Beaver, every morning he gets up and he goes, communicates with his soil. He's probably going out there and digging into that soil and smelling the actinobacteria. Scientists have shown when you smell that earthy smell, it actually makes you, increases your endorphins, makes you happy. So Rick in the back 40, he's getting happy. He's getting happy. Don't let anybody see you, then they know you're disturbed. You're smoking too much cover crops. I've been accused of that. This is the science that we missed in agronomy, that they didn't give me. Holism, ecology, it is ecology. I love the definition of ecology. It is relationship. Relationship to the plant, to the microbe, to us, those cows, all of us. We have organisms in us, they're on us, they're ubiquitous, they're everywhere. Everything is connected. One of the principles you can learn, you're connected to everything. In fact, Eric here has 4 to 6 pounds of organisms in him and on him. In fact, they're part of us. Everything's connected. Everything is a whole. We need to see the holes and patterns. Okay? Now, here's the science that I think is just phenomenal. It's going to change modern agriculture. It is changing our world. It is called the science of biomimicry. I made this one up, Jay, called ecomimicry. Eco means the house. Mimic nature. Eco is the house. Dr. Janine Bania says she's got 3.8 billion years of research and development. Nature has that, 10 to 30 million species. Let's see what we can do to engineer by mimicking nature. She says, let's look at the ideas of biology. Velcro was designed by a weed, the burr. Those little hooks, the engineer said, hey, I'll create this and become a millionaire. Very cool, biomimicry. They are creating the hulls of the ship, this outer skin, and shaping it like a shark, because the way it glides through, it reduces fuel usage, friction loss by 5%. Biomimicry. How did the Wright brothers learn how to fly, Ellen? Did they just get high and eat mushrooms? They watch the birds. How about in this other country? They are using biomimicry in Zimbabwe, and they are building the buildings like termites in their mounds. And they're so efficient, they reduce their air conditioning costs by 90% by watching the termites and designing the outer skins of it. Biomimicry strategies. Biomimicry has been around for a long time, ladies and gentlemen. It's in the Bible. It's been saying, ask the beast and they will teach you. Look at the birds. Do you know why we missed it? It was in front of our face. She says, why don't we learn how to farm like the prairie and the forest? Brian, what can we learn from those pictures? When do you observe? Does it get fertilized at night? Somebody coming from the co-op and fertilizing it? What's going on there? What can we observe from that? It's diverse, isn't it? It's covered 24/7. Levi, do they till there? What is our tillage machine? Earthworms, the arthropods, the critters, they aerate that soil, the roots of the plants. Talk about it. Now, you probably say, well, Ray, you're stretching this. Really? Scientists say, look, the applications and principles and patterns can apply into agriculture, but it's rarely applied. Look at the researchers. People have been observing this for years. Why is this coming out now? Because we're desperate. People are feeling the pressure and the stress, the climatic, the economic. We're finally saying, look, sober up, look, let's look to nature. This is the most powerful tool besides understanding. It is a shovel. I'm gonna ask you, ladies and gentlemen, producers, how many of you use this precious tool to communicate with your soil on a regular basis? Excellent. There's an anomaly here in the forest. I usually only see one, and maybe not even one. This is encouraging. Okay. When I dig into your soil, this is what the soil will tell me when I dig into your soil. I want to see 4 to 5 earthworms at the minimum for shovelful. That means I'll have 850 to 1.5 million earthworms that can churn about 18 tons of soil. In a year, an acre, they will regenerate that soil in 27 years. Your whole farm will be regenerated in 27 years. They will purge the E. coli, the salmonella of the soil. Those little vacuum cleaners, they go in there and they suck those particles and they release these powerful enzymes to cause the little protozoa to explode and they poop out this rich phosphorus, nitrogen-rich poop. They're awesome. They are they're called the soil engineer indicators of health, soil engineers. Keystone organisms, earthworms. They are needed in the system. Aggregates, cottage cheese. I want to see cottage cheese in your soil. So when I look at it, it should look like cottage cheese. If you see no cottage cheese, and I'll show you a better picture, that is indicative you're chilling too much and it's carbon starved. It takes energy to build the aggregates. The aggregates in the pores are the lungs and the circulatory system of the soil. I want to see living roots. And I want to see residue called the detritosphere. I want to see all those present. Every one of those have to be present. Every one of them. I don't want to see any of them missing. If I dig in a forest, if I dig in a prairie, if I dig in a healthy zero-till system, they will be present. This is a sand being fused together by these biotic glues. I want to see all that present. Okay? This is how they look. Aggregates. They're kind of a fused aggregate. These are biologically done. Glomalian, glomalin, they create this. Look at this beautiful, elegant universe. This is a subaquatic ecosystem. It runs on water. This is a system of aggregates fused together to create this elegant underground cavern where they swim in this beautiful underworld. This is their world. What do you think a vertical disc or a tillage will do to that elegant universe? It diminishes it. It changes its ability to hold water and to filtrate. You can see it when we did it here. Let's look at Odette Menard's picture from Canada. This is in Canada with no-till, and going Quebec, where no-till is not supposed to work because it's too cold. Look at the earthworms, take that, and bring that. I never knew that earthworms can be that strong. This was taken with a special camera at night. It is absolutely beautiful. This is the reason I do not go out of my garden at night. I disappear. Where's our blood? I know. Cell phone gone. That's all you can hear. He's gone. Look how. Now, what do we do with our residue? We bale it, we disc it, we burn it, we ship it off. And then you go to the co-op and write the front of the check. This is precious carbon. I do not give my carbon. That runs the system. How about that, earthworm? I would say, Jay, you go check the corn. And no, Beck, you go check. No, I'm not going to check. You check. Look at how it changes the, this is a model of these latex material they pour into these wormholes. Can you imagine the infiltration rate? So when you've been in drought and all of a sudden you get a massive 1 or 2 inch rain, everything infiltrates. In some of our forests, some of our prairies, 27 to 50 inches per hour. Now if you run the disc, you sever that beautiful elegance and break it up. I move my cows. I manage everything to make sure that these babies are taken care of. They drive the system. I gotta be cognizant. So you get up in the morning and your wife asks you, what are you doing, husband? I'm going to make sure my micro herd is taken care of. We don't think that way. We gotta go see what chores we have to do, right? And get the day done. Look at these precious protozoa. The protozoa are like this cheetahs and the hyenas of the Serengeti. Protozoas eat the bacteria. The bacteria are like the gazelles. It sucks to be raised up as a bacteria. You know you're gonna be eaten. This is part of the nutrient cycle. What causes them to come? Once you put a living root, here come the bacteria, they multiply, and then here comes the cheetahs and the hyenas. Nematodes, there are good nematodes. We need nematodes. When the nematodes and the protozoa eat the bacteria, they release ammonia secretions. According to Dr. Laval, excellent book on soil ecology, he says we can get anywhere from 17 to 116 pounds of N just through predation. Where is the nitrogen coming from? It is coming from that. It's coming from a lot of places. We tend to ignore that. Okay, look at the calcium being held, electron image. Who would have thought that fungus are holding on to calcium crystals? Those are calcium crystals. This is the new fertilizer, slow release fertilizer. You know what I like about that? I don't have to pay a special tech fee. I don't have to put it in a bottle. I don't have to go spray it. It's in my soil. They store the nutrients. I want my nutrients in the body of a microbe and the plant so my soils do not leak. And the more I do that, I get to write the back of the check. What a novel concept. How many of you have sandy soils? Raise your hand. Okay. You know how we can increase the cation exchange of your sandy soils? That is sand being fused biologically with the organo-mineral complexes. Look at this sand particle, how it fuses and coats that sand particle. Now I can regulate temperature, pH, matrix potential, electron conductivity, cation exchange capacity. Now my sand has cation exchange capacity. One disking can destroy that little universe. That is my sponge. That is their house. This was not taught to me either. Who would have thought that organisms, plants, can take up organic forms of N? I thought it was only ammonium and nitrate. they can take up amino N. That was recently shown in Science Daily. Mycorrhizae taking up amino N organic forms of N and taking it back to the mothership called the plant. Look how powerful that is. These mycorrhizae, this is the influence of the roots without mycorrhizae. Look what happens when you have this fungus building this beautiful marriage with the roots. Now I can take up water this amount of area, thousands of times of area. Huge. Now I can bring up phosphorus. I can bring up zinc. I can bring up all kinds of other nutrients. This helps me become more drought tolerant. This helps me be more drought tolerant. 80 to 90% of our plants are mycorrhizae. Mycorrhizal, corn, soybean. But it hates this. It hates tillage, over-fertilization, too much phosphorus, disking. Hurts that beautiful, elegant, underground soil web. Okay, how many agronomists do we have in the crowd? Anybody want to claim that they're an agronomist? Okay, Mr. Agronomist, what were we taught in college as the most limiting nutrients in soil?
Probably nitrogen.
Oh boy, you could not graduate until you repeated it several times. Nitrogen.
Calcium.
It is carbon. Carbon drives the whole system. It is carbon. It is the organism that will hold on to the calcium. If I feed them, I get the carbon cycle right, the nitrogen cycle. I look at them together, don't look at them as separate. Nitrogen, organisms use it to fulfill protein synthesis, but they want food. This is the food. This is the way it should look. If I take the plant and soil biology out, I have geology. It is biology that builds the physical, and it regulates the chemical. This is the correct way of looking at it. If I had a t-shirt, it would say this, and I'd be screaming it out. Soil is alive. The producers that understand that their soil is alive, it changes them, it changes their lives. Look what a living soil can do. This was taken in France. This is conventional. This is sandy soils. The conventional, and look at the no-till. Why is there less snow in the no-till? Audience? Why?
But who said that? Biology. What a beautiful person. You got it. It's the biology. There's more of those little factory workers working.
They can weigh up to, 2,500 pounds, and some healthy soils all the way to 10,000 pounds per acre. It's the biology. Okay. Now, this one's a new one, Mr. Fuhrer. This is when I went to Hawaii. I got back from Hawaii. What a poor thing. I have to go teach soil health in Hawaii, right, Jess? I really suffered. But I had to take one for the team. Now, in a hot, humid environment, in the tropics, organic matter up to 14%. Then when we start farming, 7%. How powerful is the biology for regulating chemistry? Look at organic matter. Remember when I told you how organic matter is made? It is made by the biology. Look at all these other substances, but it is one. This one helps increase cation exchange capacity. What does that mean? It has the ability to hold on to those precious nutrients. Look what happens. This is Palau. Palau, the island in Guam. A soil scientist gave me this slide. I said, oh, beautiful. Organic matter, when it's at 16%, look at the exchange capacity. Very good. Once it drops to 2%, look what happens. Same with grass, same with ferns. Now look what happens with aluminum toxicity. Look at the pH. It doesn't change that much. But once it goes down to low organic matter, look at the concentration of toxic aluminum. Ooh, biology makes the organic matter. Guess who's regulating the chemistry? That's why we say highly buffered soils. This is what happens when you send foresters unsupervised without a soil scientist. Those trees are dead. They're toxic to aluminum. Aluminum toxicity. Mulch, look what happens when you do the right things and look at this tree. Now look at here. A farmer that grows bananas, he uses hog effluent. Now look what happens when the Chinese learn American agriculture. Chemical fertilizer, tillage, which one do you want? Let's reduce the stress. Again, very destructive. When you till, again, we tell you the glues are not there. It implodes, the aggregates explode. Let me show you a good picture of this. There you go. There's my cottage cheese. When I see most soils, they're like this. This is what I want. If I walk into the field, this is what I'm looking at, Sheldon. See how you're becoming a soil whisperer? Beautiful. Can you believe those are the same two soils? They're side by side. Corn and soybean. For years and years, nature's way of farming, our way of farming. Good, healthy no-tills, I have seen them like this. With cover crops. Look at the electron microscope. Look, if you go zoom down, this is the upper 9 millimeters. No pores. The no-till. Look at the pores. The glues are holding the particles open.
Fully appreciate.
Now let's look what happens. Let's see how this will pass.
I'm more willing to do that. Here in Virginia, we use a rainfall simulator.
You guys hear that?
Our farmers tell the story of what happens when it rains really hard.
This is Chris Lawrence. Let's see what happens when the biotic glues are not present.
On the left, we start with a tray of dry, loose soil taken from a clean till field. On the right, we start with a slice of intact surface soil from a long-term no-till field. This soil is not only protected with a mulch of cover crop residue, it also has a stable porous sponge structure.
You know, years ago as a kid, I remember, you know, you'd get these big heavy thunderstorms in the summer and it would just wash the field and you'd end up with mud down the road. And I'm talking about mud that you'd go over there with the skid loader and scoop out of the way so the cars could go down the road. What I'm seeing now is I'm seeing these heavy rainfalls and I'm barely seeing a trickle coming out of the field.
After we simulate an extremely intense thunderstorm for 5 minutes, the differences are obvious. Most of the water we apply to this soil has run off into this jar, carrying away with it a thin but very significant layer of topsoil.
That's Chris Lawrence from Virginia. But of course this only happens in Virginia.
We just applied an inch and a half of very intense rainfall to this bare tilled soil.
Look what happens. It just applied a couple of inches.
Obviously we harvested very little for future plant use. Meanwhile, this no-till soil has absorbed virtually every drop of water we applied. What little ran off is clear. The bottom line is pretty simple. If you want to harvest more rain like these no-till farmers are doing, keep your soil covered on top and make it a sponge underneath.
Okay, now let's look at our grazing systems.
Between a continuously grazed pasture versus a rotationally grazed pasture. To really see the difference, you actually have to be out there during the heaviest thunderstorm of the year. NRCS uses a rainfall simulator to demonstrate the effects of infiltration versus runoff on pasture surfaces. These pasture samples were collected from actual pastures just down the road from each other.
And this is happening in our range.
One represents overstocked and overgrazed pasture. The other represents a rotationally grazed and rested pasture. All rainfall runoff is funneled into a collection jug on the front of the demonstration table. This allows us to visually compare both the volume and clarity of the runoff.
They also have holes.
The nutrient we have to manage is water. With rotational grazing, particularly during the summer, we have more water infiltration because we have a better cover on the ground. Essentially, the cover intercepts the water particle and allows it to enter into the ground versus running off.
Look at that.
By the end of the demonstration, it's amazing to see how much more runoff occurs on the continuous overgrazed pasture versus the well-rested rotational grazed pasture.
These are infiltration. They got holes in the bottom. This is what infiltrated.
Here you can see how much more water actually soaks in and absorbed under the rotational grazed well-rested pasture, and how much more water actually runs off.
Okay, audience. Here's your quiz. Why, if I drop that aggregate from that upper grease, if I get a chunk of soil from there and I drop it in there, will they break up? It does break up. Drop it in, slakes very little. But why is the water running off so much on that field? What do you think is going on? Compaction, I'm not going to argue that. What else?
Surface ceiling.
I'm not going to argue that either.
Mycorrhizas. Fungi.
What happens if we got rain coming down this hard to stop the kinetic energy of the raindrop? That also impacts it. And you know what we've noticed in hay fields? Even if the grass is that high, it still runs off. I don't know what hay fields are doing, but they are taking so much from the system, it runs off anyway. Doug Peterson showed me that. I could not believe in continually hay fields, even if you have cover, it runs off. Again, messed up the system. This one. How critical is it how we farm? Very critical on how we disturb the upper surface. And I cannot, and producers, even after they hear this, but Ray, but I'm only touching that little part of the surface. The microbes on the top 1 inch to 2 inches. Look how critical if you don't set the equipment correctly. This, Carol, look at this with high disturbance with the drill. Look how it has impact on the CO2 release. No disturbance, low disturbance, and when you don't set the equipment correctly, look how much water, CO2 is evaporated. Now we talk about chemical disturbance. What happens if we use our fungicides and an insecticide capriciously? Because here's what we'll do. A co-op will say, hey, you got a little spot of we got some fungicide, you have a little problem here. But I heard that George had this problem here with grubs. You want to put a little bit of insecticide while we're out there at the same time? Not knowing that you can hurt the fungus with fungicides, it affects the springtails, and it affects the beautiful, elegant universe of soil food web. And then guess what happens? You land up right in the front of the check again. Poor nutrient cycling. Look at here, a tropical forest. Look at the diversity. These are the components that push carbon through the system. Look at here, a prairie. Look at Iowa. It's these organisms, the beneficials, regulate the pests. What was it, Jay? How many thousands of beneficials per every pest? Is it 3,000 or whatever?
Lots.
They control it. But if you go spray, there's no control because you kill your factory, you kill your army. Grow a living root, the other principle. One night, man, I was reading a really cool technical paper and I was really pumped up and I come out of the house, what? I get it. And she says to me, what's wrong with you, husband? And I said, the plant and soil are one. They are not separate units. They are one. And I was so excited because the moment you take that crop up, make it one again. Feed it, bring the healing, bring the energy, and to feed this beautiful universe. Most of our organic matter is coming from this, feeding the system. The moment you drop that seed, do you know what that seed brings to you, Ryan? Opportunity. Opportunity to capture energy. The moment you drop that seed, it starts making this elegant collaboration with the organisms. It starts leaking these compounds, communicating to the biology. It's beautiful. Look at how this is where life starts. This is where it feeds the system. Right here. This is why we want a living room 24/7. You can see the little babies grazing. It's like a little baby's nestling at his mama's udder. It is right here. I want this conduit of energy to feed and build my organic matter and get me off the chemical treadmill. Right here. I want amino acids, organic acids, all these compounds leaking in my soil. That's why we do all these mixes. We want it to leak. And then we get a yield increase called the rotational effect, because you're exciting biology that's never been excited before. Here's an excellent book called by Dr. Robert Pinton, about $200. It just focuses on all the hundreds of chemicals that leak, diffusates, excretions, secretions, allelopathic chemicals. Look at them. Look how powerful. They even, nature has its own herbicides. This is taken by the Dakotas. Look what happens in early spring, weeds. But if you make a cover crop design, look at how beautiful it suppresses weeds. Oh my goodness, somebody's calling me. Sorry. Is everybody's phone off?
It's the wife, too.
She already knows where I'm at already. She's got a beacon on my head. Compaction. I love showing this one on compaction. What do we do for compaction, young man? What do we do for compaction? Huh?
You reduce it?
Yes.
Metro way, chill.
We chill, baby. We got the diesel. We pump it in a big tractor. Horsepower, don't we? How's that plant doing it? Producers, that's a serious compaction issue. How do you deal with that compaction issue? Oh, those plants are heavily mycorrhizal. It's powerful excretions. Bacteria can dissolve rock. The biology modifies the physical. They can do it. I don't need to put diesel in it and make the payments for a long time. I use biology. I took this, Mr. Fuhrer, in Hawaii. That is solid rock lava. How did that plant do that? David Lamb, a buddy of mine, was with me. He was like, how can that grow out of rock?
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle. Let's all repent and cry. Here's what happens. All of a sudden, these water lands, it rains, you get these crevices, organisms fall, they start the process, breaking down the rock, a seed lands in there, you got primary succession, the enzymes and these powerful acids, and they start dissolving and bringing the nutrients out of that rock. Look at this plantation. That soil is this deep, that hard. Oh, but I got a compaction issue. Oh yeah, but Ray, you're showing this all over the planet. It doesn't happen here. How about Iowa? Let's see what Iowa's done about compaction.
You're gonna plow seeds with antibiotic of that can-do spirit that you find in American farmers. And so when you say that there may be better alternatives to tillage for compaction relief, that seems somehow counterintuitive and almost un-American. I met two guys from Ohio State who use science to put conventional wisdom on its head. We're trying to tell farmers that you cannot solve your problems with steel. You know, steel is shiny, you can put your hand on it, you can spend a lot of money on steel. And even with a subsoiler that may have minimal surface disturbance, it's really not solving the problem. You know, we're seeing that soil structure can be better solved by using natural rooting systems through our cover crops or continuous no-till from the cropping systems. And we have some other experiments here that are proving that. We have some compaction plots comparing subsoil steel versus living cover crops. We're purposely compacting these plots in the fall under moist soil conditions by using a grain cart and going back and forth over the plots and enforcing that compaction.
This is very heavy clay soils in Ohio.
We're comparing that to using a subsoil.
Oh, look at the yield differences. Cover crops, beating, fall.
And of course, when you get some heavy rains, you can see staining water problems, you know, that show up between the compaction levels of the plots also. And the cover crops are outdoing the steel.
So what's the explanation for these rather surprising results?
When you look at a soil, you have to look at the components. And the major component of most soil is sand, silt, and clay. Now, that makes up about 45% of a really good soil. The other part of the soil, what we tend to forget about, is it should be pore space. Almost 50% of a really good soil is pore space. But then the most important part of a soil is the organic matter. That's like your head and your brain. That controls most of the chemical reactions, and most of the life is with that organic matter. You know, when you start to till the soil, what you do is you burn up the organic matter. So in the last 100 to 150 years through tillage, we've lost probably at least 60% of our organic matter. Some studies say as much as 80% of the organic matter is going right up into the atmosphere. And this is a good area because this was the Black Swamp in northwest Ohio. When the first settlers came here, they said our soil was as black as midnight. And when you look at the soil now, you'll see that it's not as
look how hard that soil is.
It's kind of a brown. It's lost its color. It's lost a lot of its
oil. Brick.
I like to tell farmers that a lot of times when you till the soil, you turn it into cement mix.
Okay? Look at
the cracks. Soil gets very hard and dense. And one of the things that we've learned is that if I was going to drill
look at that crack.
Cement, I would start with a small drill and then use a bigger drill to go through it. So that's what we do with the cover crops. The cover crops actually have very fine roots and they form a small hole. And then
the patriarch of covers.
Soybeans, and those corn and soybeans will follow those same channels down through the soil. And they also follow earthworm holes because earthworms are fairly big and they're also enriched with them.
Okay. Now, cover the soil all the time. Okay, here's the other principle. Here's what we want to do with our covers. Right here, as you get the crop up, we have leaks in the spring. We're not capturing solar energy. We have leaks here. We want to cover the leaks as much as possible. Cover it with covers. Look how Dave Brandt is doing in Ohio with his cold clay soils. This is a planting corn into standing covers called green planting. This is going to be the wave of the future in modern agriculture in a lot of parts of the country, where you're capturing solar energy to the last minute. You're protecting and you're nurturing the microbes. And this is farming in a non-intrusive way. Isn't that beautiful? When I started farming like that, I got goosebumps. I didn't have dirt all over my face. My machines don't get dirt everywhere. It is awesome to farm like that. Look at those elegant covers. His neighbors, the widows, come up. It's very competitive for land over there in Ohio. Very expensive. He gets calls from the widows and say, Dave, can you farm my place? It's so beautiful when you put those covers out there. And Dave says, sure, I'll plant your place. Look what it's done to his soils. It was the organisms and the plants and doing no-till that changed it from here to here. His soils look like that. Now he's planted this is a soybean field that received no herbicide. All they received was rolled down rye. That field, 14-acre field, produced 68 bushels of soybean. No herbicide. When the drought came,
2012, we only got 8 inches of rain. This is Dave's, 140-some bushels. The neighbor across the street, 40, 60, 70 bushel. Covers are spreading all over the country. In the Idaho, in all the little, even the rural people are picking up about covers. This is a veggie no-till drill for tomato. Tomato no-till transplanter. Drop the tomatoes in there, go in there and put your tomatoes in. What is this, audience?
It's a cover crop seeder and sprayer. Why would farmers spend thousands of dollars to buy one of those?
Oh, it doesn't pencil out.
They do it because they understand soil health. Now look at some of you got really excited when you saw a ladder on top of the other ladder. You got some testosterone going in there, didn't you? For a split second. Look what we want. Look at these other farmers.
This not as pretty.
Why would they do that? For this. We want living covers, feeding biology, so when you harvest the corn, there it is. Look at what we're doing in North Carolina. Oh, in Indiana. Ray McCormick, you remember that? Ray McCormick, he went to North Dakota to go see Jay and them. And when he came back a transformed man. He went to the Jerusalem of soil health to repent of his ways. He came back, and look what he built. Oh, look at that, I don't have time. This man, you know Lucas, right, Jay? This guy is amazing. He farms soils this thick. He farms about 1,500 acres, I can't remember the exact. Last year he did 850 acres of corn and no-tilled it into standing cereal rye that high. His dad said, fought with him, don't do it, Lucas, you're gonna have a failure. The neighbors are gonna laugh at you. He's our district board member and he says, I don't care what the neighbors say. I'm going to do it. Look at the slope he farms. He did it, he planted, and it was beautiful, and the corn came out, and he got 190 bushel corn. He was so excited, he put it about 40 units of N, side dressed it right there. The corn was beautiful. This year, his yields were 200 and some, and now he's gonna do the mixes. He's gonna start putting the legumes in with the cereal rye. We do it in North Carolina, where we're rolling it. We get the old cultipacker out, and we no-till our corn plant or our corn right into that big, heavy, thick material. We're using it in cotton, using spreading and broadcast as we're spraying. And in the following spring, it comes up and you have that much biomass. That's why we're increasing our organic matter in those areas. And look how beautiful that corn comes out. You see any weeds? I'm personally convinced in North Carolina, if we bring in our 15-inch row and do cereal rye and roll it down, we could do no-till corn and no-till soybean. Not because we want to be no-till, because it's the right thing to do. We're going beyond organic because we don't want to spend money, we don't have to. And look at my instant detritus here. Look at the temperature difference. 92 degrees, side by side, 77 degrees. Back to carbon. Now, synergize. This is how we design our mixes. We want to mimic biomimicry, the ecological architecture. We want that in our mixes. We want to get away from this, get away from that. We want this, but now we want to integrate cows into that. This is what we want, because it looks like this, the prairie, the forest. Okay? This is how these beautiful mixes look. And when you start doing those mixes, Rick, right? Isn't it beautiful? And guess what happens? They come. Synergy. Here's where I learned, and they took this poor little agronomist that was lost, and they taught him. Notice, does it say advanced no-till?
It doesn't say advanced cover crops. It's not about tools, it never has been. It's about the understanding. Jay and the district manage this beautiful farm where people from all over the world come and to see and to learn. The farmer said, let's do our own research. Let's get field size research. We have one now in Missouri. We have one now in Indiana. They are spreading everywhere. We have, in NRCS, we have taken our plant material centers and we are growing multi-species cover crops and we are doing our own research so we can learn how to do the mixes. That's why I got messed up here. Here is where I learned that nature is more collaborative than she is competitive. My slide's messed up, but this is the beauty. I remember, Jay, when you first sent me this, I was a believer, and I didn't even see it, 5 minutes, okay. I was a believer. They planted lupin, oil, fascia, purple, cowpea, cocktail mixes. This is where I learned that I learned in college was not correct. I learned that competition was dominant in nature. Look what happens when you have a drop, when they got 1.8 inches in a monoculture plot. It looks like death. Monoculture grown by itself, look what happens when it's grown with the oilseed, but look what happens when you bring all of them together. When I saw that, because we got a lot of blowback by, I had to go look at some of the research papers. And luckily for me, in January 30, 2013, a paper was written by Dr. Mark Burtness at College Letters, professor of biology. He says natural ecosystems, he's done a meta-analysis of plant communities all over the world. He's discovered that when plants are under stress, they do not compete, they collaborate. Think about it, if we had massive stress, our forests and prairies would dry. The system's more resilient than we ever imagined. Hey, how much time do I have? 5 minutes, 4 minutes? I'll just go real quickly in the animals, and we'll call it, and then I'll wrap it up. Ladies and gentlemen, I went to college here in New Mexico State. This is the range site over there. I was born in 1961. I did not know that we had short steep prairies. Look what happens now. Prairie, when you don't have an understanding and you use the tools incorrectly, now we have mesquite that invaded the area. It shifted, this is called a phase shift, when nature goes from one phase to another, created by stress. So guess what? Our researchers blame the cow, and it does this, and we take animals out of the system, now it becomes worse. The cow and grass are designed to be together, not separate. This is where I was telling you about how we model it. In the book, Resilient Thinking, this is how it's explained. Think about these bases as these energy fields and how they control nutrient cycling. This little ball represents nutrient cycling, the ecosystem services. This is the threshold. This system went from this to here. It went to another regime and went to another threshold. The goal is to keep the little ball on the bottom of the basin. That's called equilibrium. But when it goes to another threshold, it shifts to this. And it's hard to bring it back from here to here. Let me explain that here. With our soils. Our soils do the same thing. It is no longer, that's why I hate when people compare no-till to conventional. They are total different animals. They went to a different regime. They went to a different threshold. This is why we didn't understand no-till and it failed and we had yield drags because we were not understanding what the system was doing, okay? But now, we are bringing it back by biomimicry strategies. We're using cows and run them like buffalo. Mob grazing works on humans. My daughter has been in the military 5 years. No, she's a lieutenant. Very picky eater. When they tell you only have 20 minutes a chow, they eat everything. Same thing here. They become aggressive. They bring in the, they push in the material. They defecate, urinate. They become aggressive. They eat the weeds. This is bringing ecological memory. This is Gabe Brown, and he's got thousands of acres, and he can let the cows run everywhere. He doesn't do that. This is what I want from the grazing. I want to see this to get this. And we don't do it all the time. We do it as a tool to do this, to feed biology. Okay? This is his tillage machine. So is this one, there's Gabe's. This is what I like. This is a bat latch, ladies and gentlemen. This has a battery operated, solar powered, got a bungee cord, a solar panel, buzzer, timer. Set the timer, buzzer goes off, cows hear it, bungee cord releases, the cows move to the next paddock by themselves. He's really, Gabe eliminated ivermectin in his operation. Now the cowbirds eat the ticks, eat the flies off them. Look at his son Paul, sets all these in less than an hour. Also too, they're running chickens right behind the herd. Same thing like the Serengeti, the birds follow the cows. Here is a solar power panel, I mean a solar battery operated, solar driven. When it gets dark, goes off, shuts the gate, chickens are in it, has a water tank, and they follow the herd. Pretty nice because they're making about $5 a pound for the chicken and $3 for the eggs, and he cannot keep up. Now, we'll wrap it up and we'll get a couple more. This was Chihuahua, Mexico under very dry conditions. This was given by Jim Garish. I asked, can I have these slides? This is in Mexico. Look at continuous grazing, 15 years without cows. Can you see the difference? Not much difference. The turning of continuous grazing, 15 years without cattle grazing. Look what happens when you do biomimicry. Run the cows like buffalo in 8-inch precip. All of a sudden, you're choking and killing the mesquite. The grasses come back. And look here, choking out the cactus. We have seen transformations in the landscape by understanding. Look at this ranch turn from here to here by using the cows, feeding the microbes. Okay, I'm gonna wrap it up. I don't have enough time. Usually that's the problem. Listen, I'm trying to do too much. Try to do a 5-day course in
7 days.
Yeah, I'm trying to do the course too quick. But here we go. Last couple slides and we'll call it a quits. Let the next speaker come out, and you guys will be, thank goodness we got Archuleta off the stage. Hey, my wife and I want to move to southwest Missouri. We're going to buy a little farm. One of the things I want to do is get a little press. See, because I know the diesel was designed by Dr. Diesel to run in vegetable oil. I want to run my pickup, a diesel pickup. That's not my pickup, but I want to run my equipment. I have irrigation. I want my farm to run on new sunlight, not ancient sunlight called oil. Producers, why are you not allowing your soil to drive your equipment? When you go to Europe, you can buy a tractor right off the factory that runs on vegetable oil. You can be more free than all of us energy. So at the end of the day, some people say, well, Ray, what kind of indicators do you look at if my farm is actually working? Some look at organic matter, and I do. That's a nice storage of energy. But when it's all said and done, when I know that you are applying all the principles and you understand, guess what happens to you, to your operation? A lot of your inputs, petroleum-based inputs, go down. It goes down.
and you start making more money. Because you are working off biodiversity, you are running on new sunlight. Your system is highly ecologically and economically resilient. Nature does not put her eggs in one basket, but we do, corn and soybean. Gabe puts it in many baskets. He makes his system resilient. Am I opposed to these? No. But ladies and gentlemen, if you're really honest to yourself, and at the end of the day, your majority of your expenses is to do maintaining equipment and infrastructure and logistics, which is driven by this ancient sunlight. Our producers that are working with nature are making money. Because what we have done, we have worshipped yield. And it comes back again at the end of the day for highly effective people. And the farmers that do apply these principles do not worship yield anymore. Because they understand that human integrity equals ecological integrity. I'm not going to go over all those habits. You'll have to get the book, because the book is worth it. Leave you with the last story. It's a true, it's called a fable. It's because we're out of balance. And I thought this story was a beautiful, elegant way of talking about balance. This farmer found this precious goose, and it laid the golden egg. That's our soil. This is the producer. And he was so excited, it laid this precious egg every day. But then he got greedy, and he wanted to get more golden eggs. So he opens the goose, and he says, no egg. See, because we don't have the balance between production and production capability. What really is what we want in the future is sustainable yields. Some of us want 300, 400 bushels, the land pushing it hard. That golden egg, they killed the goose. We are killing the goose. Ladies and gentlemen, if we help and be humble and understand our balance, and this principle applies to all our lives, being balanced. We are working way, we work many, many hours. We work so hard to maintain infrastructure. Last statement. The new standard at the coffee shop is not how much yield you have. How much money did you make and how you did it? Farmers for the 21st century that are going to survive are going to apply all these principles. Those are the ones I think are going to survive for the 21st century. I want to thank every one of you for coming today and for hearing me. And I know it's hard to sit for a long time. And I said, thank you again. I'm done.